The following is a production of the Dallas Genealogical Society. For more information, please visit our website at www.dallasgenealogy.org.
Well, what we intend to do today is celebrate the existence of the Dallas Genealogical Society. As you're going to see it in a few slides, depending on where you choose to mark the beginning or how you choose to mark the beginning of the society, it's really kind of a question of interpretation, because we have several different beginnings. Whenever it started, I think that you're going to see at the end of the presentation, we have a remarkable history. It's certainly worth celebrating any time you choose to do so, and we're choosing to do this one now. We're going to take a look back at some of the significant accomplishments and some of the influential people who have helped shape the history of this great society. And since the focus of society so much is on the Dallas Public Library, I think that's probably an appropriate place to start. So I'm going to hope you can hear me. Dallas didn't have a public library until 1901. There was a group of citizens around the turn of the century that said we really need to have a library in the city. Promoted for it, agitated for it, started raising some funds, and finally with a $50,000 grant from Andrew Carnegie, we were able to fulfill that dream. And this library, built in the corner of Commerce and Harwood Streets and opened in 1901, was the first Dallas public library. The first floor contained the volume of the collection, just under 10,000 volumes. The second floor initially was an auditorium and an art room, although a little later in its history, the library did move some reference material upstairs. But, you know, the early parts of the 1900s, if you're talking about the Dallas Public Library, that's what it looked like. In 1930, on June 1st, this article ran in the Dallas Morning News. It was an advertisement with an intention to form what was then called the Dallas Genealogical Society. And I think it's interesting to see what some of their objectives are listed in the newspaper article were. They wanted to foster an interest in genealogy in local history. They wanted to provide research facilities in connection with genealogical material to the Dallas Public Library and other local centers. They wanted to concentrate on the collection of genealogical, biological, and vital records of Dallas. And then this one. Employ a competent genealogist to aid members in tracing their own names. So to understand that, I will just refer you to an excellent article in the anniversary edition of the Pegasus, which talks about kind of genealogists who go around for large sums of money to actually research a family, produce a book, and present it to you. And sometimes they even complain or contain actual real information about your family. And so there's a lot of these kinds of people running around at the time. In fact, there was actually a lawsuit, a suit here in Dallas that's held. One of the early members of this early edition of our society testified in that trial. And unfortunately, the company that was ripping the family off won. But that was just kind of how it was back in the day. There was an organizational meeting held on October 3rd. It was held at the North Dallas High School. And this man, E.B. Comstock, who also happened to be the principal of that school, was elected the first president of the society. Now, the following year, they elected John Howard Payne, notable for being just a hair before 4 feet tall, I understand, was elected as the second president of the society. And we know that he was still president in 1933 when the DGS donated copies of the 1850, 60, and 70 census records in Dallas County to the library. What's interesting was how he got them, or how we got them. E.B. Comstock went to D.C. and transcribed them from the originals. I typed them up, bound them off, and presented the book to the library. But as far as we can tell, that's about the last we hear of this original edition of our society. It just kind of faded from sight. But given what was going on in the country and going on in the world at the time, it's really kind of understandable. You know, spite of the Depression, in 1932, people were concerned about whether their bank was even going to be open or if their savings would be there. This was the time of the bonus marches. The World War I veterans who marched on Washington trying to demand early payment that had been promised to them for the service in World War I. It was about the time of FDR's first term as president, and people were standing in long lines just to get food. It was the time that the Indian Conservation Corps was established. By 1935, there had been more than 500,000 men enrolled in this program. And if you know that, the very family resemblance of the man I have sort of read that says he's my father. He served there for 2 years. As if the economy wasn't bad enough, we have things called Dust Bowl. We had dust storms rolling across Kansas, like this one in 1935, and this one, the Panhandle in 1936. So it's understandable that the early people that tried to get the society going had really, really pressing important things on their mind, and genealogy just wasn't one of them, apparently. Fortunately, the Dallas Library had their sight on the future, and they hired this one, Margaret Louise Barrett-Pratt, in 1937. She was an SMU graduate. She had met and married a fellow SMU graduate, and by this time was widowed and had an 8-year-old son, and was hired as a reference librarian, working in the original library. and you're going to hear a lot about her in future presentations. She had a lot of influence on this library and on us. She was there after World War II. She was there from the Korean incident, as people didn't actually participate in, like to call it, but it's an unarmed war. And finally, things kind of settled down, you know, globally, economically, socially. And, you know, about 1954, 1955, people were starting to form societies and get together again. At this time, the city of Dallas realized we had outgrown the original Carnegie Library and were in the process of tearing it down and building a new one. So all of the books were moved over to a temporary location in Union Station, the big enough building and strong enough building to support all the books. And so that was the location of the Dallas Public Library for this couple of year period. During this time, Margaret Pratt was given a donation, a whopping $50, and told to spend it wisely. And she very wisely spent it all on one book, a book printed in 1886 on Virginia Huguenots, which also is going to play a prominent role here in a minute. She was there when a man named John Plath Green came in. Like many genealogists, he got interested in genealogy because his mother had died and he received a bunch of stuff from her. And going through there, he came across something that he just didn't understand. Of course, he went over to the Dallas Public Library for some help and said, "We have this thing about French Huguenots. You know anything about that?" And she had just recently received a book and gave it to him. He was very impressed, helped him get his genealogy moving again, and just really cemented his interest in genealogy. This is the time of Walker's, B. Brown Walker, who I believe was going to be, you'll see, was elected president in 1963. His wife, who was one of the first secretaries, were frequent patrons of the library as well. So all these people met there and kind of under the influence of Margaret Pratt. When John Green approached her and said, "Well, do you think it's time to try to organize another genealogy society?" She said, "Yeah, I think it's a really good idea." She started calling all of her patrons who she knew were interested in genealogy. They were all excited about it, and they only had one request. "We need to have a meeting at night. We can't really meet during the day." Temporary library wasn't open during the day, so she arranged through some connections she had to use the auditorium over at the Dallas Power and Light Auditorium, or Dallas Power and Light Building, to use the auditorium. And that's why they had this organizational meeting. Apparently, it went really well. People thought, "Yeah, great idea, let's do this." So on October 26th, they held the first monthly meeting at the downtown YMCA over on Irving Street. John Green apparently was on the board of directors there and was able to use facilities. They decided to select the name of Local Historical and Genealogy Society as the name of this instantiation of the group. John Green was elected the first president. And that's why I see it's E.B. Comstock, the first president of the first society, was named as the chairman of the temporary finance committee. So that loop kind of closed some 25 years later. The purpose of the organization is kind of interesting to me because I think it's fun to see what the people who started the society thought was important. Not to mention the fact that this is all that's still written in our charter and filed with the state. So this is as much true for this organization today as it was when this was created back in 1955. So the purpose of the organization was to create, foster, and maintain interest among citizens of Dallas County in the genealogy and local history section of the Dallas Public Library. To collect, preserve information related to those pioneers who settled Dallas County into the early history of the city and county. To preserve church, cemetery, and land records, testamentary documents, diaries, manuscripts, and other source material wherein are chronicled the achievements of those who laid in the wilderness the foundation of this great community. To copy and index all such records and to catalog them so as to make this information most rapidly available to present and future generations. To collect and make available, through the Dallas Public Library, published records of other states once came the Texas pioneers. And to exchange ideas and collaborate in devising efficient methods for genealogical and historical research. So pretty true of what we're doing today, I believe. The first educational program was held that February. It was a how-to session on genealogy made by John Green, then president, and Mrs. Margaret Scruggs, who was one of the first directors of the society, and again held at the YMCA. They started publishing a newsletter right away, the beginning of a very long and proud publishing history of the society, which we'll talk more about in just a minute. And it began doing what we've been doing for 60 years, acquiring and creating records. And so they started working on a bibliography and helped with other societies purchase some census records in 1880. And again, we're hearing a lot more about that. In 1955, the new library opened at the site of the old Carnegie Library. The city had hired some consultants and had received some advice on how to organize the records a bit differently than they had originally. And one of the recommendations was to combine history and the genealogy departments together into one group. They decided to do that. They go to Margaret Pratt, named the head, the first head, of the Texas History and Genealogy Department of the library. The first clinic, kind of the forerunner of our symposiums and seminars and institutes and everything else, was held in October and November. It was four two-hour presentations on how to preserve family records and do family research. Mm-hmm. And unlike what we do today, this one was actually free and open to the public. In November, the charter was presented to the members that were present at the meeting. And so those that were there were able to sign it. So there we actually have our 32 first charter signing members of the society. And this was finally filed with the state of Texas and stamped as officially creating the Dallas Book of the Historical
Society. Local History.
The what?
Local
History and Genealogical Society. So we became official as a society in December 1955. Which why either by plan or by amazing coincidence, but I think it was a plan, was why we issued the 60th anniversary edition of Pegasus last December to mark the 60th anniversary of the society, and for us to launch a year of celebration, which we're concluding with today. So if you're wondering why we picked the dates that we did, we were either incredibly foresightful or incredibly lucky. This, of course, was all duly chronicled in the newsletter, in the March 1956 newsletter, mentioning the fact that we incorporated it officially. We've spent an incredible amount of time going back over all of the publications that we've produced over the years, which is the basis for much of what we've done. And so it's worth spending just a few minutes talking about the evolution and the history of these many publications and the various forms that they've taken. So I'm going to do that. And also point out that this is the first chance that you get to have an opportunity to have a drawing for one of our lovely DGS hats. So I'm going to count the number of publications that we've produced in the end, where whichever group of people guess the right number is going to have an opportunity to win one of these DGS hats, so keep your fingers crossed. So as I said, it started right in 1955 with what I'm kind of referring to as a newsletter. It was published kind of sporadically. It did seven the first year, and then two, and then six in 1958. But finally, by 1959, they settled on a pretty regular schedule and did them four times a year. It was referred to in this time either as a bulletin, or the newsletter, or the quarterly. But it wasn't until 1964 that they actually changed the name of the publication to the quarterly. So this first part started out kind of newsy, folksy, but it pretty quickly got into being more records and methodology oriented as our current edition of Pegasus is. But looking back at really this 1955 to 1963 period, it was more of a newsletter than anything else. So I kind of broke it up in a separate category. So through 1963, we published 37 of these early newsletters. In 1964, they renamed it the Quarterly. It wasn't until 1985 that they renamed it the Dallas Quarterly. Initially, it was a larger 8.5 by 11 publication, and in 1982, they squeezed it down to a smaller 5.5 by 8.5 staples thing, according to what I read as a cost-saving measure. And this was published for 21 years, the last issue being produced in December of 1994. And it was produced, amazingly enough, four times a year, leading up to the quarterly name. So there's 124 of these produced. We're going to total so far up to 161. In 1976, we began issuing publishing a newsletter. And we're still, unfortunately, of all these publications that I'm talking about, the only one issue we're missing is the very first edition of this newsletter. Mm-hmm. We thought we had it, but what they had was a quarterly, not a newsletter.
Oh.
So folks up in Paris, Texas thought they found it for us, but they didn't. We published 311 of these over the years, with the last one being issued in January of 2015. So it brings a total up to 472. In 1995, we ceased publishing quarterly and went to an annual journal. And this again is a larger 8.5 by 11. And this is printed through 2012. In 2001, we actually won a first prize from the Texas State Genealogical Society in the Journal of Harvard Society Contest here. One of the years of Barbara Ware edited, so we did a nice award from that. We did 18 of those, so our grand total is 490. But we had one more thing, the Pegasus. In 2013, we needed the publication of the journal and replaced it with Pegasus, the Journal of the Dallas Genealogical Society. And so we now, since then, have been publishing this twice a year. And in 2014, under our veteranship of Marion Zabel, this was again recognized by the Texas State Genealogical Society in their official periodicals of Harvard Society Contest when we received first place. As I said, we have six of those, bringing our winning number up to 496. So Todd, Or Christian, do you have?
I do.
Yeah, well, I believe that is number C.
Number C.
Letter C.
Four people can get sent, right?
From the net. I'll send anyway. You look honest. Give it me.
Right here.
Thank you very much. Only four people. In 2010, we began printing something then known as the e-glass, a normal electronic way of communicating. We renamed that to e-news in 2016, and this is now the official DGS electronic newsletter. The venue of that is just frequency. We've sent about 170 of these out over the period. That's about twice a month. So we like it because it's very easy and lets us communicate with you very quickly and very frequently. But we didn't include that in the account just because it didn't seem fair. Our logos evolved along with everything else. In 1963, we actually created our first logo, and if you go back to the March 1963 newsletter, there's an article in there that describes what the star represents, what the laurel wreath represents. So I just encourage you to go take a look at the website and really learn more about what they were thinking when they thought this one up. This is a lot of thought into it. Not only that, that's our way. They actually have a lot of thought into it. In 1975, a member named Carol Kupfer redesigned the logo for us. And it's very lovely, and so they decided, of course, to immediately rename the society and change the logo again in 1977. So this is the logo that we've had since 1977, and the name of that, they changed the name back then as well. Probably because of the charter updates. In 1963, we chose to update the original charter because originally the charter was filed as a 50-year organization, and they changed it then to a perpetual. And I guess that was kind of a time when they said, well, gee, we need a logo too. So that's when we came up with that. In 1976, we updated the charter again with the name change. At that point, we went from the local history and genealogy society to the Dallas Genealogical Society, the name we've had since, December of 1976. Today's mission statement is just kind of a condensation of those original points that we have, and we've chosen to use this as the way that we want to organize the rest of the presentation. So in a minute, Carolyn Davis is going to come up here and talk to us about what we have done to educate by creating, fostering, and maintaining interest in genealogy. She's going to be followed by Barbara Ware, who will talk to us about the things we've done to collect, preserve, copy, and index information related to Dallas County and served history. Kathleen Murray's going to talk to us about the things we've done to assist and support the genealogy section of the J. Garrett Johnson Central Library in Dallas. And then Lloyd Bachter is going to give us his perspective on how all this looked from his side of the desk and some insight there, and then I'm going to wrap up and close things up for us. So in the spirit of how things look at this time, we're going to tell you this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Your chance?
Yes, please.
Those are here.
Okay.
You got it.
I'm not sure. So Tony is just displaying that way?
Yep.
Technologically challenged.
We've rehearsed this plenty of times.
Yes, we have. The my point today is to talk about one of our missions to educate by creating, fostering, and maintaining an interest in genealogy. And we certainly have done that in spades, I think, over the last 60 years. It's always been an important mission for us. One of the first ways that we have helped to educate our members has been the sponsorship of our Salt Lake City trips. And the first trip was in November 1963. Sammy Lee and Dorothy Bruce organized the first one, and I think the first few that DGS members with research experience in the family history library act as guides. Before the group went, there were pre-trip orientation classes. There was a special get acquainted reception at the hotel in Salt Lake City when people arrived, and a banquet or a dinner on the Monday evening with a nationally known genealogist. The first several, I believe, were fundraisers for the DGS Capital Expansion Project, which was the expansion of the 8th floor genealogy section in the Dallas Public Library. Barbara Bayless, Madeline Crane, Pat Hatcher, and Mark Rubeck also were guides in at least the first trip, and I think some of the first few. Our members helped with research problems that participants had, and they arranged for Salt Lake City professional genealogist Arlene Eccles to do one-hour sessions with each person. And there were about 20 people. There were 25 people and 6 guys on that first trip. We peaked in 1998, which was the 6th trip, with 53 people, 49 participants, 3 guides, and 1 coordinator. The last trip we had was in 2012. During the second trip, which was May 9, 1994, Lloyd Boxrock went along and provided a private one-on-one consultation for each participant during that week. So this was an incredible educational opportunity for the people who were able to make it, and it was very popular. It looked like there was a pajama party going on here in the top slide. From left to right, according to someone who's identified these people for me, I don't know them all. Art Rubeck, Dorothy Bruce, June Shipley, Terry Allen, Shirley Sloat, Jan Cunningham, Mary Lou Coleman, and Jenny Fales. So this was part of the first, this was during the second trip. And the bottom, I don't know when the bottom photo, which year that was, but again, this was a great educational opportunity for our people. We have not organized a trip since 2012, but Mesquite goes every year, and they're going again. What month are you going?
October.
Oh, there you are. October.
Last week of October.
So there's still a great deal of interest in people doing this. And Mesquite, if you're interested, I'll be publishing some information about how you might join with the Mesquite group. But another major way in which we have provided educational opportunities for our group is they've had many different names over the decades, whether they have been workshops, lectures, seminars, institute. But the focus has always been the same, to bring to Dallas nationally known and respected genealogy lecturers, writers, and scholars for the education of our genealogical community. Some of our earliest educational lectures, which Tony pointed out in his section, were featured DGS members as instructors in the beginning, and were which showed the depth of talent that was here in Dallas. Tony also talked about our first workshop in October, November of 1955, how to preserve family records and do historical research. By 1956, the spring seminars began, and about 1987, the Fall Symposium and the Beginner's Workshop were combined. As I say, over the years, we've had a lot of different names, but, excuse me, I need to use the mouse here to move my home. I'm not used to using the mouse. Here it is. I got it. Maybe move it over. Here it is. I apologize. I have a few statistics for you. I don't want to bore you with that. But from 1975 and 76, the average attendance 100. 1981, the July symposium had 415 attendees, and they kept getting, they were larger. We moved our meetings to the Dallas Convention Center, so for many of them. So by the late 1980s and early 1990s, we were, our seminars and institutes sometimes have 700 plus attendees. Elizabeth Shone Mills, I think, had the record in 1991 with 724 or something like that. So we provided a lot of educational material over the years. By night, we also started a week-long program in the summer called the Institute of Genealogical Studies in the mid-90s. And it was a week-long intensive school. For example, from 1996, we organized a week-long gathering. There were eight tracks: basic genealogy, intermediate genealogy, advanced genealogy, census, or creative problem solving. For land's sake, analysis and platting. Military paper trail, on the road with IGS, exploring research facilities, and the last track was from colonial Englishmen to revolutionary Americans. And we also organized a welcome reception, a formal dinner, research time at Dallas Public Library, problem-solving sessions, and evenings were devoted to computers and the internet, and instructors' roundtable discussions. So when they say it was a very intensive time. These seminars have been our main fundraising activity over the years, and these presentations have benefited the Society and the Dallas Public Library. Our attendees have been exposed to the best teachers and speakers in the genealogy and family history fields. And here are a list of some of the ones that we've had over the decades. I think, from what I can find, at our third clinic, which is what we originally called them, in 1958, we had our first featured speaker who was not a DGS member. And that was Mrs. Virginia Taylor, who was the archivist of the State Library in Austin. And, of course, over the decades since then, we've had more people than I could get on one slide. But I wanted to say, one of the speakers that we had, and I'm not sure which year, but it was Martha Hoffman Rising. And I just read a press release yesterday from the National Genealogical Society conference in Fort Lauderdale that she was elected to the National Genealogy Hall of Fame. And we knew her when So many of our people, our speakers, are just immensely talented and qualified. 60 years of courses are impossible to distill onto one slide, but the titles of these examples of our programs illustrate the depth and breadth of the educational experiences that DGS has provided to our genealogical community. So I'm not going to read them all, but just for your 60 years of research, we have provided a great deal of information. A subset of this has been beginner and advanced genealogy classes, teaching our members and others how to do genealogy research. And it was an annual workshop in the fall for many years, taught by DGS members, and that's, I think, is very important, that our local members are very experienced teachers themselves. From 1969 through at least 72, DGS helped teach an 8-week class at El Centro. And that was organized by Mrs. Lush and Mr. Conger. And they covered, and these were local members who are speakers, Mrs. Morris, Mrs. Platt, Judge D. Brown Walker did the seminar on legal aspects of genealogy. Our first president, Mr. Green, did genealogical research in North Carolina, and others. And in the past few years, an abbreviated four-class program has been developed by DGS members and presented at various venues. We've been presented at the Central Library, we've presented at several branch libraries. We've gone to retirement villages, Clyde Warren Park, at the Texas State Genealogical Society when it was in Fort Worth a few years ago. So this is a program of ours that we have started at the beginning and are still doing in one form. Even today. Now, another way in which DGS has supported its mission of education has been to feature an instructional program at each monthly meeting presented by local experts in many different fields. And this exchange of ideas happens often in this smaller setting. So, in addition to the big seminars that we put on, our monthly meeting each month is very, the programs have been very informational. Our current Director of Education, Cheryl Friedman, who is at NGS and not here today, compiled this section. So, we had a variety of meeting places, as some of you may remember. I have been a member only since, I think, 2009, so I don't remember the meetings at Dallas Public Library. But apparently, we met at Wyatt's Cafeteria over the years, University Park Methodist Church, so the monthly meetings have been spread around. And here are some of our speakers that Cheryl compiled. Local, the Dallas area has no lack of expert speakers. And these, both DGS members and others, have presented programs at our monthly meetings over the decades. And these are some of our topics. Many times related to the Dallas, North Texas area, sometimes of a broader nature, but always instructional. And the award for the most times presenting to DGS and starring role goes to Lord Foster. We won't ask him to make an acceptance speech, but as you can see, he has honored us with his knowledge over the many, many years and topics. So we are pleased to have been the recipients of his instructions. Another way that we have been educating our members is the special interest groups, which were organized to answer the needs of specific groups of members for discussion of common interests within the genealogy field. The first one and the longest running one, I believe, is the Computer City, which is now known as the Technology City. But it was planning meeting was held in January of 1989, and it originally met for an hour before the general meeting. Pat Hatcher was the first leader, followed by Don Rainey, and there have been others since then. But I believe the second one is the African American Genealogical Interest Group in terms of, because I think it was, I know it was formed by 1995, or RL may have a more specific date, but I went through a lot of the newsletters and I wasn't able to find the exact date. Also, a professional interest group was formed at that time. There was, for a time, a Latin American interest group. And John Wiley, who was very involved in the interest groups at the beginning, said he even recalls one for a while that was for the British Isles. There was a digitization group. The MacGen reunion group, which I am also a member of, was formed in 2006. So we're going to have our 10th anniversary when we meet in June. We don't know what we'll do, but we'll have a celebration ourselves. And our newest, formed in 2015, I believe, is the DNA City. So our cities have organized, they dissolved, they regrouped as the special interests of our members have changed and developed. The current cities are the African American group. Donald Payton and Lois Lilly have lived in it. The Brown Bag, which is a continuation of the professional interest group, leaders have been Janet Kashab and Liz Coots. DNA is led by Mick Barnett. The Jewish City leader is Liz Coots. The Matching Reunion leader is Kathy Quirk. And the Technology leader is Susan Younger. There are now six, and our organization allows for the formation of others. If there is a group of people who want to do that, to form another special interest group, we can do that. And library lockings is the last slide. It was originated in 1977 as a thank you to the volunteers who helped stage the very successful National FGS Conference that was held in Dallas in 1997. And I understand that the original lock-ins went from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m.
Yep.
Did they really? The first one I went to, I think, ended at 1 or 2. And then we went off to Denny's to eat again. But anyway, it again, a great way. The Dallas Public Library was very generous in providing space, and the staff stayed on to help us. We closed the library, and just the DGS members were there for the evening. And it was reinstated as part of our 2014 Summer Symposium after that we had not done it for a few years, and it was very successfully received. And there were a lot of happy dances for people when they found what they were looking for during their lock-ins. And our next presenter is Barbara Ware, and she will talk to you about collecting, preserving, and copying.
Now, I'm only going to wear this little thing a short time since Kathleen bought it.
No, I like it.
You like it?
Yes.
It's a good look to you.
It looks My staff used to, I would go to staff development meetings at the state level, and my staff was always embarrassed because they would have some kind of little hat thing we had to do, and I would be the one up there doing a little hat thing. So as Tony had said earlier, the educational purpose of, I tell you what, I can't see guys, the educational purpose of the Local History and Genealogical Society was spelled out in the objectives as part of the charter. Today our mission summarizes those objectives. Let's look at some of the projects we've engaged in over the past 60 years to illustrate the work of the Society toward these objectives. The first project was begun by the Local History and Genealogical Society with the listing of the genealogically related books and materials in the Dallas Public Library. This was patterned after a similar project in St. Louis, Missouri, which published in book form their report in 1953. Now, you'll remember that our new library on Commerce in Harwood opened in 1954. In more recent times, DGS has published new acquisitions first in the newsletter and later on the website. Shirley Sloan created a book of Dallas County records at the library in 2011, which she has graciously made available to individuals via the DGS website. Two other aids for research in Dallas County have been provided by DGS. One is the book Doubt Search, which is also available on the website, and the other is the Dallas County, Texas Genealogy Wiki. That's because somebody got Dallas County before we did, and so we created Dallas County Wiki on the Brand Search website. Early on, society leaders sought members to participate in projects through announcements at meetings and in publications. These projects yielded a number of useful books and microforms. Over time, the officers continued to reach out to the society members to volunteer through projects for its publications, personal contacts, and meetings. You know, some of that bar quizzing, you know, wouldn't you like to participate in this project? You know, we have this available, why don't you try it? And now we look for our volunteers in addition to the old ways through the DGS website. So let's take a scroll through some of the projects undertaken by the society and its members. Now there's not time to cover everything, but if you're interested, you can go back through the newsletters, the quarterly, the journal, and Pegasus, because they are all available on the DGS website. There's also an index from 1955 through 1993 that you might want to check. It's called the Index of the Quarterly, but it really covers more than the years of the quarterly. I found it very interesting. I found a lot of cemetery things in there, so I was going copying the cover pages of each of those newsletters and quarterlies to see what cemeteries we can put onto the website. The Dallas County Records Inventory Project began in the fall of 1973 when North Texas State University received a grant under Title I of the Higher Education Act of 1965 to conduct a statewide survey of county records. The project was undertaken for several reasons: to provide information of existing local records for the Regional Historical Research Depository Program of the Texas State Library, to locate and preserve valuable historical materials, and to provide a database for record management manual for county officers. The Dallas Genealogical Society, under the leadership of Helen Liu and Margaret Smith, undertook the Dallas County effort, which yielded 35 rolls of Dallas County probate records. These rolls are now available on the 8th floor genealogy department. DGS members were involved in the project with the support of County Clerk Larry Murdoch. Murdoch surprised Helen Liu when he announced that he had arranged for the Business Records Corporation to donate a microfilm viewer in recognition of the work done by the Lowell Society. A surprise of the project was the location of two land grants in one of the probate packets. These are land grants for Gideon Pemberton, who was a Peters Colony settler, and these were signed by Governor Sam Houston. The first printed abstract of Dallas County Wills was published in the newsletter in 1957. The probate cases have continued to provide volunteer opportunities for the Society. Most recently, a searchable index based on Helen Wu's published index was added to the DGS website. And since then, the films have been digitized and placed on the portal of Texas History, and the index is being matched with the digitized images by DGS volunteers. Society members have provided marriage records for publication as early as 1956 for many locations inside and outside of Texas. When you look at our newsletters in the beginning, you see a lot of records not Dallas County, because after all, our citizens in Texas came from many other states. Many individuals have participated in the preparation and publication of these Dallas County marriages over time. The first marriage recorded in Dallas County was George W. Cox and Mary Carver, and that was on 30 August 1846. DGS purchased the microfilms of the Marriage License Index, which covers 1846 to 1963. And now a new project is being discussed to match the printed marriage records that we have published with the microfilm license index to place them online. The first set of church records collected by the Society were those of the First Methodist Church of Cedar Hill, as announced in the February 1955 newsletter. At this time, we have not found those records. We have checked in the archives. Of course, you know, they're kind of closed right now. We checked upstairs, we looked everywhere, but we have not located either transcription nor these records. Other church records have been abstracted and published in either microform or printed format. In the manuscript collection of the seventh floor of Texas Dallas History Archives is the original book for the Dallas Circuit East Conference of the Methodist Church covering 1850 to 1860. The church is listed, and these are like Sunday school lists, basically. Churches listed include Dallas, McKinney, Liberty, Honey Creek, Cedar Spring, Webb's Chapel, Cottonwood, Spring Creek, and Duck Creek. Members are designated by gender and by race. These have been transcribed and published in Texas. Cemeteries all over Dallas County have been published in various formats. This map illustrates where there is a cemetery that we have published something about. Even if it's just rest lumber, said we say, we're not doing that cemetery. Or Laurel Land, or some of the bigger ones. So at least something has been in a publication by DGS. There's a complete list of all the Dallas County cemeteries with a map on the DGS website, including those where we have not published any records. The Society has published 5 volumes of cemetery transcripts, and the 6th was placed online. And the 6th is very special to me because when Adrienne Jameson was getting ready to retire, she gave me a printout of the one that had not been published. I only have it in print form. So I took those and we put them on the website. So Adrienne's work and that of Helen Lou and Ruby Ann Darnell has been completed. Okay, there we go. Many, many people have worked on those cemeteries. These are just a few that I was able to find. And of course, the largest cemetery project, and Susan and I always ask, the cemetery is open to finish, This is our largest project for a cemetery, past the work that they did for the Buckley Cemetery. There are 26,000 burials plus online. It was a massive undertaking. The work online is completed. However, we continue to get additional information from individuals for Oakland and other cemeteries through our website. So we continue to update the website with information. I asked Susan to come and tell us, Susan to come and tell us a little bit about our new cemetery project.
Hello. We
AGS and asked us to participate in a trial of having a society organize a shoot, a one-day photo shoot of an entire cemetery. And so we identified the Pleasant Mound Private Cemetery located in Syene and Buckner, partly because there was a cemetery there, 7.5 acres, about 3,000 burials, but there were three other cemeteries in close proximity: the Pleasant Mound Public Cemetery and Historic, the Elmwood Cemetery, and then the Agudas Akeem Jewish Cemetery, all right at the corner of Syene and Buckner. We put together a project, Kathleen Murray, Tony Hansen, Barbara Ware, and I, working with Billy Graves and MyHeritage. You may recall that Billy Graves is now associated with MyHeritage, and they really wanted to see if a society could put together a little project to do this. We came to you and asked volunteers to help photograph the cemetery, and you responded very positively, very successfully. On April 23rd, there were about 18 of us who, at 7:30 on a Saturday morning, got up and went to the Pleasant Mound Cemetery, and within a couple of hours, photographed the complete cemetery. And then by the end of the week, had those photographs uploaded, and we have about half of those now transcribed. So we think this was a very successful little project. And I know some of you that were there at the Saturday project are here today, so would you stand up and be recognized as participating in this project? Please stand up. These and other folks that we were successful. And right now, I think we have plans to do some more projects like that. I'm wondering if we wait until it gets a little cooler. It was cool at 7:30. By 10 o'clock, it was getting a little warm. But thanks to everyone who participated. Thanks to Tony, Kathleen, and Barbara for helping organize the project. We thank you all very much, and we were very successful. In tandem with cemeteries, funeral home records provide a wealth of information about our ancestors. The Society, through its volunteers, have provided information from three or more local funeral homes. So I've asked Mark Penn to come talk about our newest funeral home project.
Told you this is our newest project, Christopher McGowan Cemetery Project. Now, funeral home project, excuse me, cemetery. We have folders, the McGowan funeral home project started with the Dallas Historical and Archives Division of the Dallas Public Library. Acquired the McGowan collection under its collection development policy in 2007. And Tony's already told you it's about 10,000 files. So our project, I don't know how many years it's going to take us to get through all the files. But each file has a folder. We have a database that we enter the information in, and the computer gives us a number. But the person, the people who are working on each box, and I'll be back in a while, will put a number on the box and enter it in the database, and like I said, the computer will give us a number. Now, when we first started the program, after we received the files from the archive department, the African American section, state group, changed all the files from McGowan's old files, which were the acid folders, into acid-free folders. And after we went and looked in every folder, and they had paper clips and staples. And you know how people put files together back in those days. Maybe they still do paper clips. But we took all the, like I said, paper clips and anything that wasn't, well, I won't say wasn't important, but I made paper clips and metal out of each folder. But we kept everything else that was in the folders. Now, every folder is individual like people, because it's people are different. But there's one component in each folder that every folder has. Can you tell me what that is?
That's a certificate.
That's right. So, in doing the files, we had some famous people. Barbara put Ernie Banks up there. And Ernie Banks is the brother of McGowan, Hammond, and his dad. So I brought one folder to show you some of the information that you will find in the folder. You hold for it? Okay. Yeah, you have to return it to. There's a certificate, and Ernie Banks, he wrote a letter to McGowan. The owners of McGowan's mortuary was Alto and George McGowan. So what Ernie did, he wrote a letter. To the McGowan staff, because he approved thanking them for the service that he gave his brother Benjamin, and he did one for his dad, Eddie Banks. And we have a newspaper clipping. I can't do the paper story. But here's a newspaper clipping from Benjamin Banks, whose folder that I am. And there's a newspaper clipping, so some folks have a newspaper clipping. Some folders have a program, and with pictures. Some folders do not, programs do not have pictures. And some folders have more obituaries and some don't. And obituaries are printed in the funeral program. And there's other information. For example, Ernie has something that papers about his training and veterans information and pictures. This is about some of his training. And everyone doesn't supply a picture. Like I said, every funeral program doesn't have a picture. Every file that's in our group doesn't have all the same information, because sometimes McGowan transferred bodies to other mortuaries and there's no information. So some files are thick and some are very limited. And that's what Tony already told you about how many files we've already entered in the database. So we're waiting to get our database updated by these tech people. Because I'm not a technical person, so I need to get with them. But when we enter a file in the database, we get most of the information from the death certificate. Now, if you're a diehard genealogist, you'll look through the folder carefully. Now, RL created a information sheet, and all you have to do is look on down. I don't have an information sheet, but you just go down the list. You go to the folder, see what's in the folder, check it off that it's in there. And then when the person comes to do the data entry, all they have to do is look on the information sheet and enter in the database what's on the information sheet. But like I said, if you're a diehard genealogist, you're going to go further than that information sheet. You're going to look at the folder like I do. to make sure that information she is correct. Because sometimes we'll have a death certificate that some of McGowan's people have written up, and on the information sheet, somebody might click there, check their death certificate. But if you look through that folder, you just might find the original death certificate. Because several folks have many, and then several folks have handwritten death certificates from McGowan. And when we enter the information on the database, we put the collection number for the McGowan collection. I call it the collection, somebody else might call it the McGowan Project. But one thing about the database, you cannot put the whole number of the collection because the way it's programmed, it only takes so many characters. But we get the main character, which is MA07. But the whole number is MA07115. And the thing I'll say now, I already told you every time, whenever a box is finished, a box of files is finished, we always have a number. We start a new number with the next box. No matter if it's the same year. If there's three boxes for 1970, each one of those boxes is going to have a different number. So it'll be easy for people to find and stuff. Because I don't think that it might be confusing if we had the same number for the whole year. And McGowan's files started in 1956 and they go up to the 1990s, the early part of the 1990s. And some of our files from the 1980s are missing. So I don't know where they are, actually they're missing. And we had heard that somebody could contact him to get the missing files. So I think I've given you all the information that you need about this program. And thank you.
Not an indexing project or a transcription project. This is a true archival project. They prepare the records in a way that archivists would want them prepared. And heard how she described by setting up the folders. So they worked a long time. And we're going to say, or like he used to say to Susan, when is it going to be through? But we do have, and Tony showed you this earlier, we do have online the records that are so far been put into website. And I'm sure this will be changed and improved over time, but something is available and up, so at least a little bit is there. What about other funeral homes? What about in the future? Well, I was looking through the drawers upstairs one day and found that in addition to the N.C. Smith that had already been published 3 years, we have 1909 to 1993, plus we have the day books for N.C. Smith in the back. There's also the George A. Brewer records that are available in the drawers on the 8th floor. So maybe this is the potential for a future indexing job for funeral home records. The project I began working on when I first came down and started researching was the World War I draft registration projects. One of the things you could do is you could come down to the library. They had computers set up, PGS did, and they had the microfilm from the World War I draft records there. And you could, if you did an hour or 2 hours, I can't remember what it was, you did some hours, then you got your parking free for that time. So that was one of the first ways that encouraged people to do that. We actually completed District 1. I was the journal editor at the time, and that's when I discovered that there were 5 districts in Dallas County, not just 1 district in Dallas County. By this time, footnotes had started digitizing the records, and then, of course, that's full 3 now, and of course, Ancestry has them, so we suspended our indexing project at that point because it was being done Many of the publications that the Dallas Genealogical Society publishes, of course, are available in the library, but a number of them are available for purchase on our websites. And you can go to the DGS store and look at the work of society members over time in publishing, either in feature print format, the records of Dallas County. If any of you all have worked on these projects, and I know many of you have, and you've contributed to local historians, I'd like you to stand. If you worked on a DGS project of any kind, please stand. We want to thank you for your service, as they say. I know that the librarians appreciate those records. Gail has mentioned to me how wonderful it is to have the cemetery records on, so people come in and look at those and ask for information based on our records online. And so now we're going to hear from Kathy Murray.
We picked all these pictures because we wanted to see our different ages around 1954 to 56. So that's me on the front porch reading a magazine when I'm 5 years old, 4 years old.
So you don't have to
look at those. I don't have those.
So I'm going to talk about the third consolidated mission of the Society, to assist and support the genealogy section of the J. Eric Johnson Central Library in Dallas, Texas. By now you all know that we've had four locations for the Dallas Public Library, and this is just letting you see each one of those. See if it's on. Since the very beginning, I think the thing that holds true is the first cover of the first newsletter, published in February of 1955. It's volume 1, number 1. And you can see that from the very beginning, Society did its work by cooperating with the Dallas Public Library. And Margaret Louise Barrett Pratt, whom you've heard Tony mention, was here from 1937. She was hired in 1962. She started as an assistant librarian in the reference department on the second floor of the Carnegie Library. She herself was in charge pretty much of developing that collection. In 1954, she organized the first meeting of people who were interested in genealogy, perhaps forming society. And in 55 and 62, she became the first director of what was called the Local History and Genealogy Department at the Dallas Public Library. She was one of the signatories on the charter in December and November of 1955. She served on the board of directors from 57 until 71. Retiring in 62, she had a number of different positions on the board of directors. She bridged, definitely, every single location that this library was in. She was at the beginning of the genealogy department, and she retired from it. A fascinating woman to research, and I wish I could just talk about her all morning. I keep going backwards. The first acquisition that I was able to identify in the society that was formed in 55 was that of the acquisition of an 1880 census. Many of these early projects were actually done by a cooperative effort with primarily other patriotic and lineage societies. This one was led by Mrs. E.C. Sheber. Her name was Buena Vista Lago. She was a okay, and she was great. She also, when you can go back and look at some of the histories of these people, they she was born the same year as Margaret Pratt. They graduated within a year and from SMU. They were both in the Daughters of the American Republic local chapter. So there's just a lot of cross history that goes on with these folks. And they write in the first newsletter, so there you see the effort being made and put in the newsletter, that you should make your checks payable to the Dallas Public Library. Make sure you mark in the lower left-hand corner for the 1880 Texas Census. By August of 55, the microfilms had been acquired, and at this point in time, those early typed and bound by, and it was Mr. Green who had done that of the 1850, 60, and 70 Texas Census, were replaced by microfilm. six decades of support is what we're celebrating here. And during that period of time, there's been books, film, and equipment that the Society has given to the library. There's been specific campaigns for anniversaries, for preservation efforts, for acquisitions, as well as cash donations. I'm going to go some of the growth so it's not terribly boring, and I have Shirley Sloat here to talk about a couple of the projects. In 1958, you can see we can only identify, I should say from the very outset, that Tony went through every single publication you could find in all of those, however many we ended up with, to pull out any reference to money, that was donated. And so I'm sort of doing the money angle here, and I put it into decades. So the only dollar amount we were able to identify during the first decade was really for $800 to put into a Margaret Barrett Pratt fund. And which we could identify that was actually acquired were all microfilms, and these are census from whence they came, as they say, the people who came into Dallas. So these are not Dallas County records. These are from South Carolina, Virginia, Louisiana, Mississippi, another one from Louisiana, and from Pennsylvania. The second decade, we found $300 that we could actually say was $300. Now, there is no doubt there was more than this. Effort that was not a financial effort per se, it was in 71, all of the early local historical and genealogical society newsletters between 55 and 68 were microfilmed. That was a project of the society. And in 1975, the president, Mrs. Harry Joseph Morris, in one of her annual statements at the end, says that, we made a $200 donation as a result of our 20th annual seminar and workshop. And we also gave five books in memory of our deceased members. And we honored Mrs. Lucille Anderson Boykin, with $100 and gave also two books and some periodicals. And who was Mrs. Boykin? She was the person who succeeded Margaret Pratt as head of the genealogy department. And Mrs. Morris herself gave a personal donation of six books. And I'm sure Barbara would like me to mention that Mrs. Morris also at her home hosted a tea for the retirement party of Margaret Pratt when she retired in 1962. We have pictures of this. I had a whole Margaret Pratt thing going for a while, but in the interest of time, you don't hear it. So in the third decade, you can see we can account for a substantial amount more money, $28,877. What you're seeing here is the two columns on your right. One where it says value, that's an estimated at times value that we could put into dollars for what were really non-cash gifts and then cash gifts. So you can see that these were contributions for different things, but what you're really seeing though that in terms of the acquisitions were probate records, for example, 29 books, Revolutionary War microfilm records, and then other books and materials donated over 2 years, an index to the compiled service records of all volunteer soldiers who served in the War of 1812. There's many articles in the Dallas Morning News about this period of time, in the late 70s and early 80s, that it's sort of like a little bit of a marriage here. The society got involved in doing a project, and it was written up in the Dallas Morning News. So you can go through and find numerous instances of this. And basically what it's saying is that the public library received a $2,000-plus scholar grant from the Dallas Genealogical Society, celebrating at that time its 25th anniversary, and what was acquired for, and it was toward acquiring Revolutionary War pension applications, and to complete a set of 898 reels at $12 a reel. So in the third decade, these were additional acquisitions that were made by the society, or given to the library by the society. I don't have to read all of these, but you can see that Confederate soldiers, early tax records from Kentucky, the general index to the pension fund, Union service records for the borders, Dallas County deeds, grantor, grantee indices. So you start to see an awful lot of microfilm being donated. And here is Margaret Ann Thetford writing in the family tree, which was a column in the Dallas Morning News, originated in 1974. You saw Margaret had a slide from Ann Hunt. Ann Hunt did it until 1979. And Margaret, she did it until, I believe, 1991 when Lloyd took it over. And this is a great example of, I think, the continuity of records and how they have transformed and remain accessible. So she people would write in and say, well, you know, I'm looking for this, or I have this, or I can't find that, and she would make it, you know, sound really wonderful and very engaging. She would say, well, I'm a hunch. You know, I looked up this family. It was Hiram Vale, who was married to Elizabeth, but they didn't know Elizabeth's maiden surname. She looked him up in the Memorial and Bibliographic History of Dallas County, Texas, which was originally published in 1892 and reissued by the Dallas Genealogical Society, and, well, she found the family, of course, in this index. She was always, her articles would frequently come around and point at something that the Dallas Genealogical Society had done. She, of course, was a member of the Dallas Genealogical Society. And what I wanted to point out is that the book, this is a call number and record from the Dallas Public Library on your lower left, and we still have the microfilm for that book. But on the other side, the Dallas Public Library card catalog will also tell you that we not just have a microfilm, but we have a book. And not only that, but they have basically a web link for the book. I should look more at my time. And if we click on this web link, I don't know if that's going to... Yeah, we'll take you to Dallas, the portal of Texas history, where the book is digitized. Hopefully, I don't know if I should do that for you or not. Screw it up. What do you think? Nah, don't do it there, Tom. So the ring can be used for a while. At home, it worked beautifully. But anyway, so the book is actually online at the Dallas Public Library, and at the portal of Texas history, and you can just go through and read the book. So we moved. I guess my point here is that we moved from having a publication from 1892 republished by the society, and subsequently microfilmed by the society, and subsequently digitized and made publicly available on the internet through the Portal of Texas History. So that this is a through time, and we have a few of these things that just link the society to important publications from the beginning up until the current day.
Can I add something?
Yes.
When we reissued it, it included a every name index.
Yes, that's correct. I should have noted that. Thank you. And who are you? You feel free to correct anything, right? Okay, so here we are in the fourth decade, and you can see that the dollar amount is that we were able to find is $150,640. Again, you see many acquisitions of microfilm, and you can probably read those yourselves, as well as some cash donations. And in 1988, so there's a substantial cash donation of $14,300. Up until now, we've had $500, $750, you know, $1,000, $1,200, 1988. We also then, in 1989, had a $10,000 cash in the amount was given. And that's not $10,000 for those general index to the compiled service records of the War of Spain. We don't know what that cash value is for that. That's money, that's dollars. And then we also, in 1990, begin the campaign to acquire the 1920 census. And in 1991, this is a picture of Pat Hatcher presenting a check for $15,000, you know, for Lloyd's Vacation Fund. And he's... But this became something of a tradition. So and it began really with that one you see in 1988, where these were substantial amounts of money, primarily from a very successful year, where the income that was generated by the society exceeded the cost to put on its sponsored events. So we get to the fourth decade, and the money all of a sudden is $150,640. Well, those of you who were around during this time know that the capital expansion project started about 1993. It was conceived in 1992 and launched. So it began raising quite a bit of money. We're going to take a little bit of time to talk about that because it was so substantial. But you will see here, 1991, cash donation of $15,000. 1992, $23,000. 1993, $15,000. 1994, $22,000. This was really, in many ways, the financial heyday of the association, at least from the records. In 1990, this is again in the fourth decade, the fifth decade, you see in 1996, 19,000. And then you see the big donation of $101,034. So the goal of the capital expansion campaign was to raise $150,000 to expand the 8th floor genealogical division. We'll talk more about it. And then you can see in 98, 70,000, and then 99, 23,000. So the capital expansion project itself, which was by far the most money that was given by the society to the library, it was conceived by a long-range planning committee in 1992. The genealogical interest had grown a great deal in the 80s, and the space allotted for research was confined up on the floor. And so there was a big incentive to want to expand that area. However, the city, not surprisingly, I suppose, did not have the funds to do this. And so the society took on the project. In 1993, they began the project formally. They collected money in 1993 from genealogists and many different types of campaigns, including passing ads at meetings. And in 1994, they also had a person, Bill Benson was his name, I believe, William, and he was an architect who was also involved in the society. He donated his services, not only in doing the diagrams and making sure everything that was compliant that was needed for the construction permits, but also in some of the acquisition of furniture and equipment. In the end, there was a pretty big celebration that happened where we, in June 1996, had raised $128,000. And then, of course, they had a ribbon cutting. I apologize for this picture. It's the best I can get it. But that's Lloyd Baxter cutting a yellow ribbon, standing in between the president of GGS, Leslie Collier, and the director of the Dallas Public Library, Romero Salazar. There was a formal invitation, and over 200 guests signed in at the volunteer desk for this event. And Karen Miller, who was at this time and for the previous 2 years, I believe, chair of the project, writes in the newsletter that it was a volunteer effort of epic proportions over many years. So it was a at least three-year endeavor. But it's a pretty dramatic thing, just reading about it. In 1995, and I talk about this project here, I actually spoke to do the talking, and I'll do the slides, you can do the talk.
If this is good enough.
Okay, then you're good.
Can you hear me?
Good.
I'm sure. Can you see me here? I have particularly fond memories of two projects that have both been fun and productive in our quest to provide resources to the DPO genealogy section. The first was assisting a member of the LDS Church to microfilm the earliest Dallas County District Court case papers dating back to 1846. A team of 57 people worked for over 13 months on the DPO 7th floor preparing and helping to index and microfilm the court records that would be valuable to genealogical research. In October 1996, we had volunteered a total of 3,406 hours of service to this project. And the end result was a set of microfilm reels of Dallas County District Court civil case papers from 1846 to 1900 that can now be ordered from Salt Lake City by libraries and research facilities throughout the United States, with two sets of the microfilm sets kept here at DPL, one for research at the library, and the second available to be checked out by patrons or other organizations. Besides learning how to preserve old records, we researchers had great fun, and by the way, received a bonus. It was a surprise to me, but you can already see the bonus up there. LDS credited DPL $5 for every volunteer hour worked, and are over 3,400 hours translated into a credit for DPL, 1,892 free microfilm reels that Lloyd could pick and choose from to bring for permanent thing in our library here. So, of the 57 people, could you either stand up or raise your hand if you were any part of that project of the Film Mania? Yes. But as an
unexpected and welcome follow-up to the project, superstar Alan Miller. In addition to the 450 hours that he spent on the original project, compiled an index to the witnesses to the project's microfilm records. And it's available now both at the library and on the DGS website. So Alan is here. Would he stand up big? Thank you very much. It was very fun and we learned a whole lot.
Thanks, Joe. So this is now still the fifth decade, and you can see where some computers were donated. And again, we have these fairly substantial amounts of money that were given. This became sort of at the end of the year, I think at the annual meeting in May, tradition to be able to make these large donations. In 2000, we also received a grant to acquire, it was a $25,000 grant from the Summerlin Foundation to acquire 447 reels of microfilm covering 1861 to 1881. And this was segment two of the city directories of the United States. This particular period of time was of interest because it was an era of time of a great immigration into the state and into Texas. And so these were valuable in terms of getting going back from whence they came. And letters that showed slowed in March of 2005, once again presenting a $15,000 check at that one of the annual meetings. In 2006, Shirley hardly had to sit down, you don't have to get up again. This is the 50th anniversary of the Society, and the project that was worked on was a 100,000 book challenge. Shirley, you want to do this?
This slide sort of tells it all, except I'm going to tell just a little bit more, too. This was my very favorite opportunity for a project. It was 10 years ago when we were celebrating our 50th anniversary, and Lloyd Oxford helped to identify an appropriate challenge for the year, the 100,000 book challenge, to increase the number of volumes in our genealogy from 95,641 to 100,000 by the end of 2005. So we solicited donations not only in cash, but in the form of actual publications, books or manuscripts that might provide clues to help a researcher place an ancestor at a particular place or time. The types of materials solicited included alumni lists from schools, membership lists of churches, clubs, social and political and professional organizations, town and country histories and directories, as well as family histories. And as you can see, the rule was that the official book count would be increased only when an item had been cataloged. And we achieved our goal on February 1st, 2006. The count was 100,300, with more still in the pipeline. And one beauty of the project is that we received an unexpectedly high number of books from private collections, often books that were no longer or perhaps never had been available through public channels. They applied to an amazing number of localities spread across the United States and outside its borders. Our genealogy collection, already excellent, was now even richer with research materials for our diverse Dallas population. The goal couldn't have been reached without amazing dedication from DPL staff members who ramped up to deal with the increased effort to process the new acquisitions so they were ready to place on 8th-floor shelves. They were heroes as their annual workload doubled. And so in January, we hosted a celebration to convey our appreciation to the DPL staff down on L1 and on the 8th floor. I had spent some time to identify all the activities involved in preparing a new book for placement on the shelf, and we all found the resulting workflow diagram very, very interesting. The party was, for me, one of the highlights of the project. And here it didn't quite everybody, but and Raksha was a cataloger who apparently had something known as for 100% accuracy as she cataloged. And this woman did a whole lot of work down there, and we really appreciated her. But anyway, the party was one of the highlights for me, and getting to meet and work with so many capable and enthusiastic staff members was a rare experience that I treasured then and still do. Today, 10 years later, every now and then, I'll meet one of the L1 staff or DGS volunteers who participated in the project and we smile.
So we come to then the final day in our 6-year history, and you can see that in 2006 there was a substantial donation. Again, we're looking at microfilm acquisitions. You can see some of the microfiche acquisition program I'll talk about in a moment, the Black Bibliographic Dictionary, 1790 to 1950, the Congressional Land Records, and then in 2015, the new book scanner, as well as a supported maintenance contract, was purchased by the Society for the Library. The microfiche acquisition project was a 2009 project that many people here, at least from what I read, were involved in. They're basically about three-step selection process and analysis of the fish that were available from the Family History Library by state and identification of those that we did not have on the eighth floor, and then a production of a potential selection list that was reviewed by the library staff for acquisitions. Once they were acquired, there has been, I would say, a two-phase discovery and acquisition process that's gone on. First of all, creating the card catalog records that were available on the eighth floor, and also co-locating this collection in a microfilm case storage area. And then after that, the DGS itself put the database online. So it's available, you can look at it. It's not the films, it's the actual catalog records. If you want to see what's there, you can do that on the website. There were 9 DGS members who volunteered for this and 5 Dallas Public Library staff members. I think a few of you are here. Shirley's here. Susan Younger is here. You can all stand if you want to stand again. And Gloria's here. She hasn't had to stand up yet. Yes, she did. She did the drawing. And we have then, of course, Sammy Lee, Lloyd Buckstrup, and is that Ed Fullinger? I think they're from the library. So great project there.
I just have to add something. Patrick isn't here. After we got them all in, he spent over a year putting them into the card catalog, which is, you know, over there, you don't know what for them. So it was a remarkable thing he did.
Right. So 6 decades of support, specific campaigns to acquire records, mostly microfilm, sometimes books, obviously, sometimes books, often. Preservation efforts were some of the campaigns we undertook, and then there were adversaries. There were also money given as honorariums to the heads of the genealogy division, thanking them and trusting their judgment to grow the collection, as well as to deceased members. And then there were those wonderful years when the society was able to raise a great deal of money and very, very eager to grow the department itself. So this is our next little drawing bit. And this is for a t-shirt that you can buy one, you can get one in your own size, but here's the total amount of money we were able to find. It's over $500,000 that over these 6 decades were given. And this, again, is a lower amount than it actually was. So we have to see who guessed the dollar amount.
We have 3 correct choices.
Okay. 3 correct choices. This is Patricia Stuber.
Yeah.
Hey. Well, she needs to have this, or he won't know she's the winner. He was very clear about that.
I would trust you.
And in terms of giving back to the society, in 1995, the Dallas Public Library established an award of excellence as recognition for the excellence in volunteer service resulting in the committee and the completion of projects directly benefiting the genealogy section of the J. R. Johnson Central Library. I'm going to quickly show you the list of the people who have gotten this award. You'll first recognize Bill Benson, who we mentioned, Shirley Sloat,
some of these people are so familiar to me now from having read so much. They were in Weir in 1999. And Jerry Rachel. Anybody who's here, that would be kind of cool. I don't know many of you. And then we see some people again, I think Aura Penn. Aura, my goodness, Aura. Yeah, she's here. And then Shirley, she's one of our two-time designators. So that's a wonderful thing that they did for us. And so in summary, the genealogical collection at the Dallas Public Library. The entire collection in the library was 9,852 volumes recorded in 1901 in the Carnegie Library. In 1955, the Local History and Genealogy Society was established as the Local History and Genealogy Department. They were, as you can see, sort of walking in tandem here. In 98, Lloyd announced to the board of directors that there were 50,000, he had just shelved a 50,000 book. In 2006, as you heard, 100,000 books were available. And in 2016, Gayla, who probably had to step out, Gayla Bush, told me that we have 118,998 books, 64,500 Michael Flynn rolls, 89,000 Michael Fish, and 700 Madison charts. The last three items are a bit of an estimate as they're not cataloged. And the books do include both hardback, anything that's shelves, but it's also serials as well as manuscripts. Truly a tremendous collection and a library to be proud of. And the Society has just had a wonderful relationship with the library. And we still do at this point in time. So I'm going to introduce our next speaker now. And one thing I wanted to do, obviously, it's Lloyd Bachshaw. This is the red, white, and blue are there because I started to do this. I went on Google and I just kind of made massive pictures of him. I didn't wait for like, this picture. He's there, his bike, it's Charlie, he's there. It's just this range. He's even a female at times. But when it's him, he's always wearing these ties that are like very prominent in red, white, and blue, which I do kind of know. This is the first picture I could find of him. He came to the library in 1973. This is a 1975 seminar workshop being held over at the Statler Hilton. And he was one of the counselors for, I guess, a breakout group. He could probably enlighten me on what a counselor did. And then this is a more recent picture of Lloyd when he was in 2010 at the Allen Public Library talking about genealogical trends. And the only thing I did notice is that the tie had toned it down. We have these beautiful muted reds and blues and lights, but still red, white, and blue. And Lloyd, it's here on. It's your turn.
I only have one lens in my eye, and I have no voice. So I see you as best I can, at least you can see and read my lips. If you look at the DGS in its context, its heritage, its ancestry, you're struck by lots of things. One of them I recently read, because now I get to watch Jeopardy 2 times a day. But it was one of the questions on a game show and television. Do you remember Lady Godiva? Did you read about her in your English literature class? And her husband was the Earl of Mercia. And he was a very harsh man and had a very austere, severe taxing scheme that left his subjects very much deprived of just the normal benefits of life. His wife led a charge against him to try and cause him to be swallow his words and to restore the funds to the ordinary people who need it most. She threatened that she would ride through the streets of town nude. He didn't give in. He said, yeah, you go ahead. Well, she did it. All the townsfolk out of appreciation of her standing, her influence, shut the shutters, closed the doors, all went indoors. There wasn't a single other human being to be seen anywhere in the streets of Coventry, except for one fellow, went out of hiding, peered in, and looked around. His name was what?
Peeping Tom.
It was Tom, so he became Peeping Tom. I haven't done a genealogical study to see who is the son of God. But I just didn't have time to go this morning. Very strange. The DGF, I've been a member for 43 years. And I don't think there's anyone else in this room who's been a member for 43 years. Am I correct? There is something to survive. There is another fetish, that's right. If you look at the members over the years, in education, in a life field, in a home we had, and the places that they've met and can be, eventually they ended up, as we are today, in the library's auditorium. And the previous library had an auditorium. And in one tornado drill, we all headed to the basement. Were any of you there for that event? Yes. The society was the first one to have a female member who became a certified genealogist in the United States of America, which is a man's world. It's women wanted to control the genealogy. And then there was a second one. I knew both of them very well. Margaret Pratt, as all good genealogy librarians, used her own money. Where did she go on vacations?
Libraries.
Archives. One vacation, she went to every library in the South and up the East Coast to New York, learning about the genealogical data available and bringing back ideas that she could implement here. And she started buying books once she could get money. Who was the first president of the DGS?
Green.
No, not John Blythe Green.
Comstock.
North Dallas High School. It's 2 blocks from my house. And the next one was a man. And the next one was a man. There's an unwritten rule. You won't find it in any of the rules that are published. No woman shall be elected president of the society. I was here a long time before I realized that. But that's why it's this way. Mrs. Harry Joseph Morris finally broke that tradition. In fact, we, in her educational programs, we had one education. They met at the Hilton Hotel, which was right next to the library. And it culminated the Thursday, Friday, Saturday event. Culminated on Saturday evening with a banquet to culminate the week's events in the hotel dining room. The women wore their evening gowns. They wore their white gloves. Be in the reception line. I've never seen anything like that in my life. Not up in the country in the other world. I thought, how interesting. I don't feel like the rest of these. And with those folks, of course, in those days, we had a chaplain as an elected officer. And it was an ordained clergy. So the clergyman gave the invocation. And then the presiding president began to call on all the distinguished guests in the room individually and talk on and off and invite them to say something. And it went from 6:30 to 7 to 7:30 to 8 to 9, to 10, to 11. And she was still going. And she had planned beyond the initial reception that she would have the Armed Forces Color Guard to open up the ceremonies of the officers came down the central aisle there in the dining room. And finally, she gave up, and she said, "Will the color guard please retire the colors?" No response. "Will the color guard please retire the colors?" No response. Finally, after her third or fourth plea, one person called to the lobby, and the color guard was not to be there. She said, "Well, they went home at midnight." We could laugh at ourselves. And we did so. We never got the money we deserved. I've known all three, well, I know myself. I knew my two predecessors. I met both of them. Now, Margaret Pratt and Lucille Boykin. When Lucille Boykin became the genealogy librarian, she had not worked in genealogy. She dabbled in it because she had a Scottish grandparent and a German grandparent. She was interested in both of those ethnic traditions. So, as she continued on through life, the DGS said, "Well, we want you to be the best to help us and all of our potential members. We will send you to the Institute of Genealogy in Washington, D.C. for a full week." She got first-hand instruction from the best genealogical teachers in the United States and in Britain, some of them afar. One was Dr. Gene Stevenson of Texas, the only Texan to be there. It was quite a fanfare. When I came here in 73, I started on St. Valentine's Day. When I came down in January, people asked me, "How did you come to Texas?" I said, "By Greyhound." It was the way to get here. And I stayed at the White Plaza Hotel, because it was just a block from the Dallas Public Library. And in the lobby, Sergeant Fritz ate his lunch every day. I recognized Sergeant Fritz. You know who he was?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so I heard he was killed. He's the man you see there in the White House. And I thought, oh, I'm touching history. And I lived through that. I came down, well, I'll go to the Dallas Public Library, which is this second building that we had at 1954 College, to replace the old, and it's pronounced Carnegie. He is not, you know, all the libraries are Carnegie libraries. I went to library school, you can trust me. At the University of Illinois, they told you that. With the Carnegie Library, I was walking and I looked at the door, and it looked like a storefront rather than a library. And there was this boy standing in a gigantic hand. And I thought, I've got to investigate this. The artist to me didn't have any pants on that boy. That was one of the greatest pure arts of Dallas, Texas. And people saw them. We were going to advertise new boys on the outside of the library. When they couldn't meet at the library, they moved to the YMCA because of some of the members' connections. When I came to Dallas, Texas, I met W.A. Criswell when he was on a mission activity in East Africa. And I thought, well, I have to visit First Baptist Church when I get to Dallas, Texas. of this long historical connection to the hair. And then someone told me that W.A. Crystal goes swimming at the YMCA. Well, that makes sense. It's just right next door, almost across the street. Goes swimming new. The fact that ministers are going swimming new in the public life. I only learned in recent years since retiring, you tend to read things out. Never read before. It was a requirement of the YMCA that all male be nude to use a swimming pool. I thought it was just a whim of his. That was a national policy of the YMCA. In that first year I was here, starting in February, as I came in, I spied out the land. I picked out who Mrs. Larkin must be, and I looked at all the other students, and I walked around the aisles, looking at the books, to see what we had. And later that year, we moved down one flight of stairs to the mezzanine. I wore my shorts to move everything from one floor to another. It was hot in Texas, and we were sweating like a dog. And then the director's secretary came through, and she was just a gymnast. The library staff would be wearing shorts. It was forbidden. I didn't know that. I was the next college kid, and they got hot to wear shorts. I got a very bad countenance for her. And I could read between the lines. This in the library that day was Wilbur Hamel, who had founded the Institute of Genealogy at Sanford University, and he told me about it. And I had just come out of graduate school. I hadn't worked a full year in my life. I had plenty of student debt. And how could I afford to live a week in Alabama, let alone buy a ticket on an airplane? Well, Jean Lush was the president of the DGS, and she said, "Lord, you can ride with me, I'm driving." Well, her husband said, "I'm not going to let her go by herself. You've got to have somebody else with her. You go ahead and go with her." So I got a free ride to Birmingham, Alabama. I went to the friends in the library, and they had extra money, and they paid my tuition. There are good people in Dallas, Texas, and in DGS. As the library prospered and sought to grow, it brought Pat Chadwell, the Fort Worth Genealogy Librarian, and it brought other librarians from the National Archives and George Yonker. He was really a knowledgeable person, because he had federal records that the rest of us did not have at our fingertips or even know about. When he came to Texas, to Dallas, the DGS members always turned out great numbers. Edna Perry Decker. Any of you recognize Edna Perry Decker? She was a DGS member, but she was president of the Texas State Genealogical Society. And she was up in years, not many more years than I've now achieved. And one night she got away from her attendant, and she got to the telephone, and she called me late at night. It was 10 to midnight, somewhere like that. And we talked and talked, and I thought, who's watching? Where are our kids? Where are the caregiver? And she said, "I know Mrs. Harry Joseph Mars is a transvestite." If I could just have her in the hotel lobby and push her in the swimming pool, she'd have to get undressed. And then I'd go to school. Memories I have. there is a very different. We read at all kinds of hotels. And we had our meetings in churches. And we had our meetings in the law, Grand Lodge of Texas at this time. And we brought the greatest genealogical record, John Inslee Coddington, Norman Winfrey, Dr. Gene Stevenson, Mary Warren, one of the earliest, and the Reverend Silas M. Lucas. And we even brought from England Leslie G. Pye to come and speak here in Texas. It was a wonderful place to get a genealogical education. Now, it's a wonderful place to get lunch. It's a central center of time. I appreciate you all, and you're going to have a lot more fun. You find the next person who could say they've been here 43 years. We have an old every genealogy librarian that's been around. Thank you.
Received several awards for our website from the Texas State Genealogical Society,
And we're continuing to expand into social media, primarily Facebook and Twitter, and I'm sure we'll have a team that wants to incorporate and try to use as well. Our seminars are continuing our tradition of excellence. We have surveyed the participants for the last three that have attended. In every case, we've had more than that, or at least 95% say yes, they will attend the future seminar. We've had never less than 89% say they're either very satisfied or extremely satisfied. And in fact, we've had a 97% for one of the conferences. So the things that people are saying is they like the warm and welcome feeling they get when they come to the seminar. They think the presentations are extremely high quality, and they think the people that we bring in to make the presentations are just phenomenal presenters. And so we intend to continue trying to improve this, as we did with Paul Milner. For the first time, we offered the ability to download the seminar electronically, whether it's participants either electronically or in paper format. With Denise Levin, as you've heard about, it's going to be, I'm sure, a great seminar. I think you just look at some of her titles, I think you get a hint how fun she's going to be, how to scan and all of them. Dirty pictures, save your family photos from ruin it. That's going to be a great seminar. The highlight is going to be something that we're calling an heirloom roadshow. We're going to allow participants to submit to Denise a description of some heirloom they have. She's going to select from them as part of the seminar and actually talk about how to preserve and keep that for future generations as well. So I think it's going to be a really great one and a little more interactive than some of the things that we've had in the past. Kerwisher, may I say more, as almost like saying Woody Boxrook. So I know if you know Kerwisher, you're going to really enjoy this seminar on Saturday. We're a little more excited about what's going to happen the day before. On the 16th, we're going to host a North Texas Society Summit. We just mailed off the invitations a couple of days ago. We have invited, I believe, 60 societies to participate from all around North Texas on the day before the seminar. We're hosting here. Kerwisher's going to participate and give a couple of lectures there. We're going to raise the cost and do this as we're trying to step up and become more of a leader amongst the societies in the North Texas region. And we hope that this is going to help not just us, but our societies around us plan for their success and help ensure that they're able to continue doing the things that we've been doing so well for so long. Tom Jones, another man who needs no introduction. We're going to reintroduce something that's been done in the past, and that's the day before we have an advanced classroom workshop. A great opportunity to get in very close proximity and work very intimately with a man who is just incredibly knowledgeable. So it's going to be a highly interactive event. It may involve some pre-homework, and we're going to limit this to 30 attendees as well. So just some of the things that we're trying to do to make the seminars that are already good even better. Where I mentioned the Billion Graves event, you're going to see us working in more cemeteries. Enough said about that. We've referenced the portal to Texas history quite a bit throughout this for a reason. We've got a good relationship with them. We love working with them. They've given us several grants to help get our information up online. We're one of 300 content providers, some more than 300 content providers, who are providing information that has been digitized and put online with the site that's really getting national and probably even international recognition. They get 500,000 visits every month, and it's just an incredible repository of information pertinent to the history and genealogy of Texas, and something that we really want to support. And what we're going to be doing is, you know, you've heard so much about how we've given back to the library, how much we've tried to preserve records and what have you. What we're going to do starting next year is we're going to launch an initiative to provide some funding for something that's very important for the portal to Texas history. They've just recently received something that's just phenomenal, a national endowment for the humanities grant. They've got $500,000 available to them if they can raise another $1.5 million from national. And so they're just launching this initiative. It's a three-year effort to try to raise the $1.5 million to get the additional $500,000, all of which is going to go towards ensuring that the portal to Texas history, which already has so much great information, is able to continue to operate throughout the future without waste of fluctuations in budget cycles and things like that. So this amount of funds should help ensure that the portal is truly what it is always meant to be from the beginning, which is a great repository of information that anybody that's interested in Texas history just loves to go to. So you're going to see in September, after we've had a chance to set our budget and set our targets and kind of identify what we want to do, an initiative, much like we've done in the past, to try to raise money to help support this wonderful resource. And Andrea Belden's back there from the portal, and she's going to be up here as we get out and has some cake in just a few minutes, so you can talk to her about this in the future. But you're going to hear more about that in September. One of the things that we wanted to do when we planned this was to make sure that we had some enduring legacies, some things that last longer than the cake that we're about to have out there. You've already seen the first installment of this, and that was the 60th anniversary commemorative issue of Pegasus. And again, I want to thank Sandra Crowley, Marianne Sabo, and Janet Kashab, and the others who contributed material and editing and work for producing this really wonderful legacy for us. So again, thank everybody involved with that. And that's just one thing that we're going to have to look back. And by the way, we still have extra copies of these available for sale. So if you didn't have one, or if you want to give one as a Christmas present or something, stop by Jimmy's table, and we have some more available. The other thing we did for this, and I have to apologize to those of you that work in Pegasus, because we didn't have all the stuff online when we did all the stuff. I know you're going to get flipping through the paper copies. We have since then digitized everything and made it available on the website. And so that's sort of another legacy that we have. You can go and view all these documents online and take a look at them from the comfort of your own home. The other thing that we did was took advantage of a software package that Susan Younger and Barbara Ware discovered when they had reached that history, something called the History Project. This is a free piece of software that lets you literally create a timeline. And you can go in and say, on this date, this happened, and here's a bunch of stuff associated with it. And so as we're preparing for today, we use this as a tool to try to catalog and organize the information of our entire history. And so if you go and look at this, it is available from a link on our website. You can see from the very beginning of 1930 all the way through just about current day, a multitude of events, descriptive information. We've tried to link it back into the newsletters and the quarterlies and the journals and the Pegasus articles as well. It's a fascinating glimpse of our history. It helped us, as I said, organize this talk, and we thought, this is such a good thing, we're just going to leave it as a permanent part of our website. So if you go to our website, go to the homepage, it's available there under the timeline. And it's something that you can just continue to peruse, and I think you'll hopefully find it as interesting as we did. Wow. I got to tell you, the recently we talked to the president of the society, it is humbling to stand here and represent a society with this kind of history. I mean, what an incredible, rich history we have of accomplishment and achievement. You know, it would be really easy to just go and say, well, our best years are behind us, so we're just going to kind of take it easy. But I don't think that's what you would like this board to do, and that's not what we're going to do right for the rest of our worlds. And I know with the help of all of you that 60 years from now, some guys are going to be standing here probably just as nervous as I am going, wow, what a 60 years those people have. And that's what we're going to work for, again, with your help. So thank you for sitting for a very long presentation. Kathleen, Carolyn, Barbara, thank you so much for the second event without you. Thank you. Let's go ask Kate.
This has been a presentation of the Dallas Genealogical Society. If you're already a member, thank you. Your membership dues are supporting this and other society activities. If you're not yet a member, I hope you consider joining. You can become a member for as little as $35 a year, and you can join by going to our website, dallasgenealogy.org, and clicking on the membership tab.